We're going to take a nice roast. And what we've done is we've taken a roast, we've cut the corners off so it'll fit in the kettle, and we're going to use that meat to make our stock. So we're going to use a nice roast. Now you don't have to use a beef roast, folks. You can use a pork shoulder, pork roast. You can use a lamb roast, a lamb shoulder. You can do this sauerbraten recipe with pretty much any meat. So we got a nice beef roast here, and we're going to use some of that Apothic dark red wine that we got the other week. We're going to use some red wine vinegar. We're going to use one of my homemade Weiss beers, my German wheat beer. You got to see that recipe. That beer is amazing, folks. We're going to pour it here in a second. Some paprika. Believe it or not, a little bit of nutmeg. Ginger snaps is what makes the stock, the broth, the gravy. Oh. Two red onions. And we have a pear tree out front, a beautiful 45-foot tall pear tree with 1,000 and some pears on it. And they're all in season right now, so we have pears where you put, instead of the carrots, we're going to use pear. You'll see, it's going to come out great. So when we come back, we're going to show you how to put all this together. So we've got a pressure cooker here, and we trimmed the edges off of this roast so it'll fit in the pressure cooker, just like that. So what we've got is we've got the trimmed off pieces, and we're going to make a stock solution. Grab a kettle here. We're going to make a nice stock for this to go in this pressure cooker with this beef. But, folks, I am going to use this German Weiss beer that I made as my water. Look at that. Look at that. We're going to put about a cup of that Weiss beer, that wheat beer, in our kettle. And you know that little bit that's left? You know where that's going. Oh, yeah. Oh, that's some good stuff. So if you want to know how to make the German wheat beer, I have a video up on how to make a good wheat beer. And I want to tell you, it's one of the best wheat beers that's out. You can stack that wheat beer up next to any of the good German wheat beers that are out there, and it would go head to head. It's a good wheat beer recipe. So what we're going to do is we're going to dice this beef up for our stock. I already started it. Just going to cut it a little bit more, and we're going to stick that in with that beer to make our stock solution. So that's the corners off of that beef roast there. So we're going to go ahead and put that on a stove, and we're going to bring that up to a simmer to make our stock solution. And when we come back, I'm going to show you how to put this roast in the pressure cooker with the onions and the pears and the spices and the red wine vinegar. Oh, it's going to be great. We've started our onions there. Now I'm going to show you this pear. We're going to dice up this pear. Now we're going to dice this up quite small because we want it to absolutely disintegrate into that stock solution, this pear. And then we're going to cut our onions up, about that size. Come back, I will have this pear all cut up, and we'll show you how to put this, the stock, the broth should be ready. See how it's coming? Should be ready for the pressure cooker. It's a little foamy because it's beer, folks. I'm making stock out of beef and beer. So it's going to be a little foamy until it cooks all the alcohol and the carbonation out of that beer. It'll be about another 5 minutes. It'll be more like stock. So when we come back, we'll show you the next step. There's the pears and the onions. So we're going to go ahead and put that in our pressure cooker. All of it is going to go in this pressure cooker here. Now, if you want to brown this meat before you put it in a pressure cooker, you can. But I'm not going to do that today. So we're going to take 1 cup of red wine vinegar. And that's just Walmart's red wine vinegar. It's nothing special. 1 cup. And we're going to put that in here. You know, I only need to use one. We're going to take 1 cup of red wine. Look at this, folks. Ain't that a beauty? That's at Apothic. That's at Apothic Dark. I read it on another video. I don't know if I even got it up, but let me show you this wine. Look at that wine. That's absolutely stunning. Now, it's not sweet wine, folks. That wine is not sweet whatsoever. It's a wine for drinking. Came out about a month ago at the supermarkets. It's $9.99. It's called Apothic Dark. And it's more like a burgundy than a red wine. It's more like those burgundies, those big bottles. You remember them big bottles? So we're going to put 1 cup of that in here. We're getting ready. Our stock is almost done, folks. See how our stock is coming along? It's coming along great with that beer in it. We're going to add that in a second. We're going to put 1 teaspoon of nutmeg in this. 1 teaspoon of nutmeg. We're going to put 1 tablespoon of paprika. 1 tablespoon of paprika. And that's at McCormick's Hungarian paprika. That's the best paprika that I like. You can get it at Costco or Sam's Club. Oh, it's wonderful. I got like 5 different paprikas up there, but I love that one the most. A little bit of salt, about a quarter of a teaspoon of salt. And about a quarter of a teaspoon of pepper. We're going to give that just a little stir. Get them seasonings all stirred up. Now we're going to add our stock. Now I'm not going to add that meat right now. I'll probably... give that to the dog. That's our stock. Now that's probably about a cup and a half, 2 cups, whatever that bottle of beer was. Now we're going to put our beef in here. Lightly submerge it, push it down. Now we're going to cover it. We're going to put this on pressure cook. I'm going to wet my seal here. Remember I told you always on your pressure cooker to wet your seal and then put it back in. We're going to close that up and stick it on the stove. Now we're going to cook that for 20 minutes. Then we're going to cool it down a second, take it off. And then we're going to put it back on for another 20 minutes. But the second time we're going to add some ginger snaps. That's going to make our sauerbraten gravy. So when we come back, we'll go ahead and show you the second step. Now we're going to have this today with a little spatzle. So anyway, we got that on the stove. I'm trying to reach across the counter there. So when we come back, we'll show you the next step. Okay, so we just put our sauerbraten on to cook, pressure cook. I got the burner on high. We got our water over here for our spätzle. And I'm going to show you spätzle again, just so that you all know how to do it. We're going to add some salt to that water. I'm going to go ahead and bring that up to temperature. And I'm going to take 2 eggs, folks. Make sure this is getting it. Let me move this camera a bit. Got a new tripod and it's just been a pain in the butt. Alright, so we're going to beat these 2 eggs. And then I'm going to add 1/4 cup of milk. And we're going to add, where's the salt at? Right here. We're going to add probably 1/2 teaspoon of salt. So it's a nice amount of salt. I'm going to go ahead and beat that together. Now there's no need to add baking powder or baking soda or anything to this. These are real tight, small dumplings. Spätzle, traditional German dumpling. It's very similar to my Hungarian dumpling recipe. So this is 1/2 cup measuring cup. I'm going to add 1 cup of flour to it. And I added a little bit more than 1 cup of flour. Go ahead and beat that together. It's real simple, folks. You don't throw it everywhere. So I'm just going to use this whisk until it starts getting tight, like that, because if you continue to use a whisk, it'll get stuck in the middle of the whisk, folks. So I'll use a whisk to get it started, and then I'll just use, let me grab the small spoon here, that big one back. Every time it comes out perfect. You don't even have to worry about it. If you follow that recipe, that's what you want, folks. There's no adding extra flour. There's no adding extra milk. There's no adding water. That's it. That's your spätzle recipe. Now, if you remember right, I like a little white pepper in my spätzle. So, let me grab that. Just drop the ginger. And somebody's been in the spice cabinet. My white pepper shoved all the way to the back. I got it. Alright. I'm going to add a little bit of ground white pepper. Oh, let me grab a little measuring. I'm going to add, this is 1/2 teaspoon. I'm probably going to add a half a teaspoon of ground white pepper to that spätzle, because I like a little pepper spice in that spätzle. Alright, so there it is. You can make it ahead of time, but there's your spätzle dough. You know what, I'm going to have to get a little shaker for this ground white pepper, so every time I go to get it, if you watch my videos, it's always to the back of the spice cabinet. Alright, so as soon as the water comes up, I'll show you again how to do this spätzle. But I'm not going to show you on the other grater and the colander. I'm just going to show you how I do it on the board. That's the easiest way to do spätzle. Unless you get a spätzle maker and you're trying to be perfect with these little noodles. But spätzle was never supposed to be perfect. Supposed to be a hearty, spätzle started out as a peasant dumpling because they had flour and they had eggs from chickens and they had water. A lot of times they didn't even have milk. So back in the medieval times they used water, flour,
and maybe one egg if they would, they could spare it. A lot of times they made it without egg at all, but once they got an egg that they could spare, they started adding egg to it. So this, these dumplings go all the way back, to medieval times. The Hungarians have a dumpling very similar. All the countries in Europe have a dumpling that's very, very similar to the spätzle. So it's a common, filler. You know, it's something to fill you up. So there you go. So when we come back, my water should be up to boil. And as you can hear, the sauerbraten started. So I'm going to go ahead and turn. It down to 8, folks. I don't want it bubbling over because I got quite a bit of stock in there. And if you don't turn it back, it will start coming out of that. It will start coming out of that little seal, and it'll start coming out of your pressure valve here. All right, so when we come back, we'll show you the spätzle real quick. We're going to let that go and set our timer for 20 minutes. We're going to let that beef go 20 minutes. Then we're going to take off the lid. We're going to check it. We're going to stir it around a little bit. Then we're going to add the ginger snaps. And we're going to put it back on to pressure cook a little bit. Oh, one more thing. If you find that sauerbraten is a little too sour for you, and you don't like the taste because you say it's kind of sour and too tangy, you add about 2 tablespoons of dark brown sugar to that on the second time around. When you add the ginger snaps, you add this dark brown sugar, 2 tablespoons, and you'll get more of a sweet and sour gravy rather than sour and tangy. You'll have it sweet and sour. So that's just another way to appease your palate, so to speak.
Okay, our water's coming up to boil. Now, to make this spätzle, if you go to my schnitzel and spätzle recipe, you'll see how I done it on that one. You can use all different types of boards. This is the board I just used. This is for my beef. This is a little for when I cut steak and stuff. I don't use this for anything but beef. This board here is my pork board. I only use this board for cutting up pork. So that's my beef and my pork board. This board here is the board I use for spätzle and dumplings and such. I only use that for spätzle and dumplings. I have a board that a bamboo board I use for vegetables. I have a nice board here I use for vegetables as well. It's mainly a board that sits on the counter so I don't tear up the counter, and I usually set another board on top of it. Then I have 2 more vegetable boards. Actually, I think I have probably 4 more vegetable boards. I got this little vegetable board I use. It's got a handle in it. You can never have enough cutting boards, folks. And then this here is my large cutting board that I use for cabbage and potatoes and larger vegetables. So you gotta have your board segregated, otherwise, I don't know, you can just cross-contaminate your whole kitchen. So you spread that dough out on this board here, just like that, folks. And I have a knife I use especially for spätzle. It's by Cuisinart. It's one I use. It's a long, skinny one. And what I do is I dip it in the water, and I just fling those noodles. See how it ends up being? See that? I just fling them in the water. And you can get them done pretty quick if you're not talking to a camera. And when I'm done with the spätzle boiling them, I always fry them in a little butter to give them that little edge to tighten them up just a little bit. I always do that. Sometimes I fry them in a little bacon grease. I've always got bacon. I buy bacon grease from the Amish at the Amish store. You know, if you got a Amish store or something around you, a
our Dutch store, little food market. You can get bacon grease, folks, already done in a jar. I also, every time I cook bacon, I save the grease as well. There's the first batch. Take another spoon, spread it out. I showed you this before. Catch it before it goes in there. This is much better than screwing around with those spatzle makers. You know, just do it like this. I showed you the other ways. You know, if you get one bigger, somebody will get a bigger one in their dish on their plate. They'll think they got something. It's like, hey, everybody else got a little. I got this big one. That's how my mind thinks. Yeah, see, look at that. Hope the camera's getting that big one just surfaced that I was talking about. Alright, so we need to scrape the rest of it out of this bowl. It's about two more. It's about two more, actually. I'm going to turn my water down just a little. So I want this to last. And don't worry about the ones you first put in there being done and the other ones getting overdone. Don't worry about that. I mean, it's spatzle. That's what it's all about. Got to turn that water down so I don't boil over. Who said cooking is not a sport? Cooking is a sport, folks, because you gotta hurry up and get it in. It's like getting a ball into the goal. Shouldn't have sat that on top there like that, but I did it for the camera. Alright, so there we go. Here's the rest of it. Give this a stir with the knife. There's our spatzle. Now, I made them a little bigger today. Last time you remember, I made them smaller. Let's see if there's any more in this bowl. Ain't no sense in waste it. You can take it right off the spoon, too, folks, if you want. You can even use two spoons. Grab a spoon back here. You can use two spoons and do it off of the edge of a spoon. You see that? Alright, so there's our spatzle. It only takes about a minute or so to boil. But then I always refry it to tighten it up. So let me grab one of these to show you. I made a little bigger ones today. What I do is I put them in a colander. And I'm going to show you what I'm going to do to those in a second. Okay, so we're going to dump that spatzle into the drainer a little bit at a time. You don't want that water coming back from the drain back up on your noodles. Okay, so there's our spatzle. And we're going to cool it down, folks. Because I'm going to fry this. Now, when I cool it down, it's going to tighten up, and they're going to be tighter than what you saw in that kettle. As soon as it cools down, I'll show it to you. You're going to have tighter dumplings when you cool it down. See that? They are not as big and poofy as you thought they were in the kettle, because the water will tighten them up. Now, this is the way I do it. You know, there's all kinds of videos out there. I went to culinary school in Germany, so I may do things slightly different than some of the people that just ate in Germany. So, there's the spatzle. Now we're going to go ahead and put that in a bowl. Make sure it's drained real well. Tilt it sideways to get all that moisture out. But like I told you, we're going to fry it in a little butter with some salt and pepper. All right, so there we go. There's our spätzle. Tom's Manly Meal way. Tom's way. There it is. That's what it looks like. That's traditional German spätzle, folks. Now, what I'm going to do here in a little bit, I'll show you, before we get ready to serve this sauerbraten, I'm going to fry that spätzle up. But you can eat it. I mean, you can put some butter on it, salt and pepper, and eat it right now. Because it's, they're unbelievable. But they need to be, they need to have butter, salt and pepper, and they need to be tightened up just a tiny bit in a skillet. You know, I only cook them in a skillet for about a minute. And then we're going to put that sauerbraten gravy on them. Oh, and some bread. It's going to be good. It's going to be good. So when we come back, we'll show you the next step. All right. God knows what people will say. So if sometimes if the little latch doesn't come loose. Okay, this is our first go around. There's our sauerbraten. Put it back on the stove. We're going to give this a little stir and check that meat. Look at that. Isn't that beautiful? Now we're going to cook it because we want it falling apart. Oh, for anywhere from about 10 minutes more to about 20. And we're going to add ginger snaps. Now you can get Moravian cookies. If you like, they have the Moravian spice in it, but ginger snaps are just as good. So we're going to put probably ten. We're going to put 10 in there, just into the top. Now I'm going to blend that sauce up, folks. I'm actually going to blend that sauce. So we're going to bring that back up, and we're going to let that go probably 10 or 15 more minutes on the pressure cooker. We don't want it to go too long, because what happens is when you have a thicker and you just don't have a liquid in there, it'll tend to burn on the bottom. So we're not going to bring it up. We're not going to bring it up to where it sizzles or starts to do pressure cooking. We're going to actually set our timer for 10 minutes from now, 10 to 12 minutes, and from this point, because we don't. As it gets thicker, you will burn it. You will burn the bottom of the kettle with those ginger snaps in there. So this is just another way to do sauerbraten in the pressure cooker. You got to be careful when you add the ginger snaps. Anytime you add a thick sauce into a pressure cooker, you have a chance of it burning in a matter of like 4 minutes. So, scorching and burning. So, you usually have to have just liquid in a pressure cooker. So, I'm not going to let it come up to the pressure cooker stage. I turned it back a little bit. Let it go about 10, 12 minutes or so. It's still hot. Then I'll check it. If it's not quite the consistency or the meat's not quite where I want it, I'll let it sit on the stove a little bit longer. But it's going to be right. It's going to be dead on. So when we come back, I'll show you this next step. Okay, it's been about 7 minutes. Now see how turning it down to about 8 is just starting it. It's just starting. You don't want it to go full-fledged. So I'm going to turn it back to 7 now, because we've got about 5 or 6 more minutes here, and then we're going to stop this thing. I don't want it to pressure cook the second time around, so we're going to turn back to 7, let it let off a little bit of this moisture, and then we're going to turn it back to right around 5. So we got it set on about 5. And then that'll be coming out in just a couple minutes. Get a little plate out for that. So when we come back, we'll show you how to do the sauce, fry the spätzle, get the sauerbraten on the plate, and we're going to show you what this thing tastes like. Now that you turn it down, it is just barely, you see that? It's not even shaking, it's just barely making a sound. It is sealed because your seal's up, folks. So it's sealed, so it is pressure cooking. But you've got to understand is you don't always have to have that thing going like crazy when you're pressure cooking. You can low pressure cook. And that's what we're doing in this instance. You can low pressure cook. You don't have to have that thing jiggling like a crazy banshee. It's still sealed. The seal is up. You're not going to be able to open it. A little bit of pressure is being released. It's not going to scorch. It's not going to get burnt. Because we're not going to leave it on that long. We got about a minute and a half left. I went ahead and turned my butter up for my spätzle. This is the saucepan I'm going to do the gravy in because we're going to puree the gravy up. Let's go ahead and dump that spätzle in this butter. Now we're going to add a little bit of salt. And a little bit of black pepper this time. Crank that up on high now. I'm going to get that all coated with that butter. I'm just going to get a slight edge on them noodles. And you can, this is when you can cut them. If you want to take down some of them bigger ones. Just in case you have a couple boys that want to fight over the big noodles. Seriously? I know my brother and I would have. We fought over anything. For those of you that know me and my brother, you know that's true. Alright, so our timer's getting ready to go off in just a sec. And we'll take this sauerbraten back off. Take the meat out and we'll work on this sauce. Okay, I got the water going on my pressure cooker. We're going to go ahead and put this spätzle in a dish here. Yeah, you'll get a little bit stick to it. Not a big deal. Don't worry about that. You can clean that off. You're not going to serve that. There's our spätzle. Stick this over here. So there's our spätzle. I jumped the gun on the timer by 30 seconds. Turn that burner off. Okay, so there's our sauerbraten. Now, you're going to have to use a couple big spoons to get this out because it will fall apart if you ain't careful. You can see it already falling apart. And sit this in this little platter here. The rest of this should be all those pears. Make sure there's no meat. There's a piece of meat there. Oh no, that wasn't a piece of meat. You know what that was? That was one of them cookies. We want that back in there. I thought that was a piece of meat. That's one of the ginger snaps. Now you see, you see how that sauce is? Alright. So we're going to puree this sauce up. You know, I need to go grab a towel to go over top of this just in case it gets out of hand. So I'll be right back. Folks, anytime you're pureeing up anything hot, I got this special little towel I got. It's just a small towel that's perfect for the top of this. When you fold it over three times, it's perfect for the top of this blender. So, always make sure your bottom's on too. You don't want it coming off and going on your foot. So remember, only fill it about a quarter way, because it's hot. And hot liquids tend to get out of hand. Now we're going to pour this in our saucepan over here, because if it's not thick enough, we're going to add either some more ginger snaps or a little cornstarch. But it's usually with 10 of them, it's usually with those pears and those onions, it's usually perfect. It's going to be dead on. You're not going to add nothing. Again, when you're blending hot liquids, you have to take caution of what you're doing. Start it slow. Use the chop or the grate. Don't put it over here on liquefy and let it go crazy on you, because you're going to come out and it's going to get on you and you're going to get burnt. Now you can see that gravy is coming along absolutely wonderful. Let me grab another. I think I've done used all the spoons without slots. Hold on. Let me grab another spoon here. I'm going to show you this gravy. You see that, folks? That is the consistency that you want. You don't have to add cornstarch. Alright, so let me go ahead and get this meat out here on the plate. And let me get some spatzle over here on the side. And then some sauerbraten sauce. And if you want, you can pour it over your spatzle too. There we go, folks. Sauerbraten and spätzle. Oh, I gotta grab a fork. Oh, and I got some bread. I got some rolls over here. Oh, forgot about the bread. I got some French bread. We gotta put a slice of French bread on there, because you gotta have some bread. Actually, it's Italian bread, not French. Gotta have a slice of French bread for the side of that dish. Alright. Let me get a piece of this bread and this gravy first. I know y'all like that. That's what I'm talking about right there. Here, let me move that off of there. Got too big of a chunk. That spätzle's unbelievable. This meat just pulls apart. Look at that. Oh my God. That, my friends, it's hard to do this holding this. That, my friends, is Tom's Sauerbraten. The Sauerbraten gravy. We use those pears instead of those carrots, and I want to tell you, you've got to try it with pears. If you like sauerbraten, try it using pears rather than carrots. There's pears, there's red onions. Look at me going to town.